Do you ever get scared? Do you ever get sad? Do you forget the childhood dreams that you had? Hoped it'd be better, but things turned out bad and all went wrong. You don't have to climb mountains or walk on the moon to fill up your heart like a great big balloon. If you can't sleep at night, just remember this tune and sing along. Dream on, dream on. Even when you're afraid, oh, your dreams may be gone, just dream on. Dream on. When the world says you're crazy, just tell them they're wrong and dream on.
Amen. Let's give Jesus one more praise. Let's thank him, church. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. When I watch that video, it just moves me because I see people working and sleeping and playing, and life is about loving God, and it's about loving people and making a difference in people's lives. And sometimes we can get tired of that and lose track of that. And when we get in those places, life just isn't all it was meant to be. But praise God, we have an opportunity to love God. We have an opportunity to love people. We have an opportunity to dream and make a difference and be different in this world. And it's what this series is all about. And so week one, we said we need to be different, and we got to stay in the struggle against sin. If the devil's been after you, if he's been shooting darts at you, I want to encourage you this morning. Don't give up the fight. Stay in the struggle. Don't give in. Don't start making excuses. Don't set up camp in that sin. But stay in the struggle. Stay in the fight. Get your eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of your faith. Get your eyes on the great cloud of witnesses that is looking down on us. And persevere. We can't give up. We got to stay in the struggle. So 21 days of prayer is coming up, and so excited. We're going to use our podcast room, and the content is going to be 21 pitfalls for new believers. It's original content, just like Netflix or Amazon. Original content that we have written right here. And we're going to share with you the pitfalls of following Jesus. It's good for new believers, but people that have loved Jesus for a long time. And so you want to dig into that, and you want to be a part of 21 days to stay in the struggle. And then we want to be different and edit our lives. There's people, there's habits, sometimes there's places that can hinder us from winning the championship for Jesus. Kobe Bryant said this: when I go into a season, I edit my life because I want to win a championship. And if Kobe Bryant wanted to win a championship for basketball glory, we should want to win a championship for Jesus Christ. And we should be willing to cast some things out and edit some things out of our lives so we can be different. You know, we got this Joy University coming up, Mission Possible. Tom Cruise came out with another Mission Impossible, number 7. Love Tom Cruise, got to admit it, love the guys and actors. Okay, yeah, I like Tom Cruise. Maybe I don't love, but I like, he's a good actor. Let's just keep all the other stuff, but he's a great actor. So I took the words of Jesus last week, who said we can learn from people of the world. Children of the light can learn from people of the world when it comes to being a shrewd manager. Oftentimes, people of the world put more into what they're doing than people of the light put into what they're doing for God. And so I listened to an interview with Tom Cruise this week, and Tom was talking about how busy he is and how he loves to make movies. And they asked him, well, Tom, do you ever have time just to relax? And Tom said, yeah. He goes, every single day, I watch a movie. I love movies so much that every single day I watch a movie. And so I took that and I said, well, listen, I love to preach. So every single day I'm going to listen to a sermon this week. So I got on Sirius XM and tuned into Billy Graham. I've listened to Billy Graham. If you're young, you probably don't know who he is, but he's a great evangelist back in the day. I've listened to Billy Graham every single day this week, and I'm kind of on fire for Jesus again. So thank you, Billy Graham. Way back in the 60s, he was recording and being on TV and everything. So anyways, Joy University, Mission Possible. It's for our kids. Sign your kids up. They're going to learn how to love Jesus like they never have before. So the question I want us to consider today, if you're in the room, if you're watching now, or maybe later on demand, why be compassionate? Can we all agree that it's good to be compassionate? Can we agree on that one? But have you ever asked yourself the question, well, why? Why be compassionate? In fact, it seems like in some professions, it could really hinder you if you're a compassionate person, right? So why be compassionate? Do you really want, you know, the general of the United States Marine Corps or whatever he's called to be compassionate when it comes to war? Jesus felt compassion. He felt compassion. And in Mark 1:41, we read that moved with compassion, Jesus reached out and touched him. He said, "I am willing," he said, "be healed." So why be compassionate? Well, I think because Jesus was moved with compassion and Jesus was compassionate, so we should probably be compassionate if Jesus felt compassion. But the backstory to this verse is there is this man with leprosy and he wanted to be healed and he's calling out on Jesus and Jesus does what only he could do is heal this man from leprosy. But Jesus tells this man, listen, I'm going to heal you, but you can't go tell anyone about it. You're going to go to the temple and fulfill the ritual. If you had leprosy, you were an outcast. So for some reason, you got rid of that leprosy. You had to go to the temple and let the priest know and all that. So you could re-enter society, basically. But Jesus says, listen, do the ritual, go do that thing. But don't tell anybody that I'm the one that healed you. So guess what this guy did? He went and told everybody that Jesus healed him. So Jesus felt compassion. He was moved with compassion. But this guy that he healed that he asked not to tell anyone, he went and did the direct opposite. He told everybody. And because of that, from then on, Jesus really couldn't go anywhere publicly because all of these people that wanted to be healed from different sicknesses would come to him. Be like someone today that would walk into this room and say, I can heal cancer, and someone has cancer, and they touch you, and you're completely healed, and word gets out. Well, that person would be swarmed because so many people are suffering from cancer and other diseases, right? So Jesus didn't want this to happen, but this guy went and told everyone. So now he had to retreat to lonely places because even though he's moved with compassion, felt, did what he thought he should do, well, it kind of backfired, and this guy didn't obey Jesus. And so there are challenges to be compassionate, for sure. I mean, if you've shown compassion, you understand there's some challenges to being compassionate. And one of them's anger, honestly. Jesus felt anger. He didn't feel compassionate all the time. Sometimes he felt angry. In the gospel according to John chapter 2, he tells us that one time Jesus entered the church and he saw, you know, out there that God's house was being used for things that it shouldn't be used for, and it was being used to make money, and so Jesus didn't, this was not good. And so Jesus, he sees this, and he made a whip from some ropes. And so this is taking time, right? You know, when you have to make a whip, the anger is building. The anger is, it's boiling, right? This is not what should be happening. I'm making a whip. I'm getting angry and angrier. And then after he makes this whip, he chased them out of the temple. And then he drove out all the sheep that they were selling, all the cattle that they were selling. He scattered the money changers' coins over the floor. And he turned over their table. So this is a picture of angry Jesus. He's angry. I remember one time I was here at the church and someone came in to, you know, get some food. And we have benevolent ministries. And so right outside here and next to the cafe, there's always a sign where if you want to go out and purchase food to help those that are hungry in our community, you can do that, bring that in. And we use that food to help feed people that are hungry. And so one time a person came to get some food, and I happened to be here. And so we give out a couple bags of these groceries. We know what to put in the bags. And I was feeling compassionate and feeling like, you know, was doing a really good thing. And so we get out to the car and we kind of open the back door and open the trunk. And I came to find out that they had about 12 bags of groceries in their back seat and in their car. Now, if you work with the poor, if you work with those in poverty, you understand that many people in poverty, those that are poor, that's what they do. They'll go from church to church and get more food than you may have at your house because they don't know when they might get food again. But for many people that don't live in poverty, that aren't poor, and don't understand that, and you work hard for a living, and you know, you're making your pennies stretch as far as they can, when you come across someone that you feel might be taking advantage of the system or taking advantage of the situation, and I'll just have to confess this right now, that was me in that moment. I got a little angry because I thought to myself, well, you have more food than I have at home. So instead of feeling compassionate, I felt a bit angry and I walked away from that situation. And that can happen. That can happen. Well, Jesus, he also felt disappointment. There was a time that Matthew tells us about in his gospel, chapter 17, when there's this boy that is demon-possessed or has this sickness and he needs healed, and his disciples can't heal this boy. They don't have enough faith. And so Jesus says to them, "You faithless and corrupt people, how long must I be with you? How long must I put up with you? Bring the boy here to me." So Jesus, he's been with his disciples for a long time, and they should know how to do this by now, but Jesus, he's disappointed. He's, "You faithless and corrupt people, how long must I be with you? How long must I put up with you? Bring the boy here to me." One time I was, again, here at the church, and a gentleman by the name of Farrar came by, and Farrar and I became friends. He was an alcoholic. He was a drunk. He was continually drunk, and so he would often come to the church and talk to me, and I knew if we didn't get Farrar help at some point, he would probably die from this alcohol, and so my goal was always to get him to the crisis center, and so I built a relationship with him and prayed with him, and this was over probably a two-year period. Well, one day we were out doing some mulch, and here comes Farrar. And he comes and says, "You know, hey, Pastor Dan, I see you're doing mulch. Yes, we're doing mulch, Farrar. Can I help and earn, you know, $20? And I said, "Well, Farrar, we've been over this before. We don't give out cash because sometimes people, you wouldn't believe this, Farrar, but sometimes people take that money and go buy things they shouldn't buy." So Farrar is like, "Yeah, you know, you've told me that before. I know, Farrar, I have. But if you'd like to help, you can help." And so he went ahead and he helped out. And so, you know, we were talking and praying. And so I said, "Farrar, you know, we really got to get you to the crisis center. We got to get you down there." And he said, "You know what, Pastor Dan? I think today I'm ready to go." I said, "Really?" He goes, "Yeah, I think I'm ready to go." I said, "Well, then let's go. Let's go down. We'll get you there." And so we jump into the Jeep, and we start heading down 30th Street, and he starts kind of shaking a little bit. And I said, "What's wrong, Farrar?" He said, "I'm nervous. I'm really nervous." And I said, "I understand that." He goes, I need a cigarette. I said, "Well, do you have any cigarettes?" He said, "No." He goes, "I need you to buy me some cigarettes." I'm like, "Okay. If I buy you cigarettes, will you check into the crisis center?" He said, "I sure will." So we pulled into the Giant Eagle parking lot, and I bought Farrar a pack of cigarettes, and he lit one up and started smoking, and it calmed him down, and we got settled there in the parking lot. I said, "Okay, you ready to go now?" He's like, "Yeah, I'm ready to go." So we go down 30th Street. We jump on 77 South. You picturing this with me? We're headed down 77 South. Now, we're going 65, 70 miles an hour because I want to get Farrar to the crisis center before he changes his mind. And as we're going down 77, Farrar proceeds to open the door and says, "Pastor Dan, if you don't pull this car over, I'm jumping out." I said, "Farrar, you told me you're going to the crisis center." He goes, "I changed my mind." I said, "Well, Farrar, shut that door." He goes, "No, I'm not shutting the door. I'm jumping out of this car if you don't pull over right now." I said, "Farrar, you're going to the crisis center. Shut the door. You told me you were going to go. We're going to the crisis center." "No, I'm not." He's about to jump out of my car on 77. So Coach Hansen came out in that moment. And when I was Coach Hansen, I allotted myself one swear word a year. As Pastor Dan, I don't let myself have any, but as a coach, I let myself have one. And I used that one cuss word in that moment, and Farrar shut the door because he had never heard Pastor Dan talk like that before. So we get him down to the crisis center, and he goes in there, and I'm praising you. I'm like, "Thank you, Jesus. Forgive me, but thank you, Lord. We finally got him some help." Well, 2 days later, I went down to the crisis center to check on him. And the lady, they really can't tell you what goes on with people that check in, but in the way that she could tell me without telling me, if you get what I mean, She said, well, he's not here anymore. And I was so disappointed. I was like, after all that, I was like, God, after all that, I mean, after 2 years, after all these prayers, after that crazy situation, I mean, God, don't you want Farrar to be free from alcohol? I mean, don't you want him to be delivered, God? Don't you care? I mean, this was the prayer of a pastor. And I don't know if you've ever been there. If you've shown compassion and you've really tried to help people that need help and you've gone the extra mile and you've done everything you can do, but they just keep turning away from the help that they need. And you get to the place where you're so disappointed, you're like, why even try? Like, why try? And then Jesus felt betrayed. In Luke chapter 9, here he is with his closest followers having this meal right before he's about to die for them. And he says, listen to me and remember what I say. The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of his enemies. Sure, in that moment, I mean, to feel betrayed is one of the worst feelings that you can feel. I was in a men's study with a guy. Love this guy. I mean, we shared things. We read the Bible together. We prayed together. I mean, he was a friend. He was a good friend. And one time, he asked me for some money. And again, my personal policy has been to never give out money, and because people just tend to take money and use it for things that aren't good. But this one time, I broke my personal policy because he was my friend, and I trusted this guy. I mean, I knew him, and for sure, surely he wouldn't. So I gave him money, and I didn't see him for like 2 years. And I knew he had kind of had an issue with recreational drug use. So I thought, well, he told me that he needed it for this or that, but I kind of have the feeling he went and bought drugs. Well, I get this call. Again, this was like 2 years later. And so I get this call and I answer the phone and it's this guy and he says, hey, Pastor. And I said, hey, it's been a long time since we've talked. And he's like, yeah. He goes, the reason I'm calling you is because I did check into a crisis center because I had a drug problem. And do you remember when I asked you for that money and you gave it to me and I told you I was going to do this with it? Well, I really didn't do what I told you I was going to do with it. I bought drugs. And I'm calling you to tell you I'm sorry. And this is part of my recovery. I said, praise God. I said, thank you, Jesus. I said, one went one way, but thank you, Jesus, one went the other way. And the other day, I saw him, and he said, Pastor Dan, I'm 7 years clean. I'm 7 years clean, and I haven't touched drugs, so praise God. He said, we can feel this compassion. We can be moved to compassion and do things for people, but when we get angry and when we get disappointed and when we get betrayed, it's so easy to say, you know what? I'm just done. I'm done. No more. But I think we have to ask ourselves this question. Well, I mean, if we're done and if the church is done, then what would life look like without compassion? If we just had enough with people, I mean, let's just be honest. If we just had enough with people, because they can be difficult, if we just all give up on compassion, then what would life look like? My life and your life in this world. So I came across this video this week. The worst day in Formula One racing. The worst day in Formula One racing. When people had the opportunity to take action and help someone that was in great need, but they chose not to. But there was one that chose to help. But it was the one that you really wouldn't have expected to. And so this is just a couple minutes I want us to watch this, and then we're going to wrap up with something that I think everyone is going to truly enjoy.
The incident occurred on lap 8 of the race. Williamson blew a tire at one of the quickest areas of the track, reaching roughly 140 to 150 miles per hour, and slid right into the Armco barrier. The Armco barrier wasn't correctly attached and worked like a springboard, propelling his car across the track and upside down. Williamson's car caught on fire while rolling over the track, and the smoldering wreckage ultimately came to a halt. Williamson was stuck beneath the automobile, and at this point was still fully conscious and yelling for help. While drivers continued to race, one decided to pull over. David Purley got out and raced towards the debris, attempting to turn the car over. Despite his greatest efforts, he was unable to complete this task. The track marshals, who did have fire extinguishers, merely stood there and just watched. Track marshals in those days didn't have any sort of fire suits. Seeing how much fire there was, I guess they didn't want to risk their lives trying to save Williamson. Some marshals went towards the automobile and opted not to use their extinguishers, instead simply just standing there. Two marshals attempted to help Purley overturn the automobile briefly, but shortly gave up. The crowd stood there in shock and disbelief, and once they realized what was going on, they began to rush forward. It was at this time that the marshals began to intervene, not to assist Williamson, instead choosing to move the crowd back. Purley obtained a fire extinguisher, but it was insignificant to extinguish the flames. The fire blazed on, and Williamson continued to beg for Purley to get him out. At this point, Purley was running all over the place, begging and pleading for track marshals and police to help him. The race continued, but drivers at the time didn't know the severity of the accident. Purley attempted to flip the automobile again, but obviously lacked the necessary strength. The marshals were not wearing any fireproof clothes, as I earlier mentioned, so they couldn't help raise the automobile and also couldn't put the fire out. After a few minutes, it fell dead silent. Roger Williamson would die not from burns sustained from the crash, but from smoke asphyxiation.
Jesus told a story that is strikingly similar to that true event. He said a Jewish man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho, and he was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him up, and left him half dead beside the road, very similar to the man in the car. By chance, a priest came along, but when he saw the man lying there, he crossed to the other side of the road and passed by him, much like the track marshals with fire extinguishers that did nothing. A temple assistant walked over and looked at him lying there, but he also passed by on the other side, much like the police that could have helped overturn that car. Then a despised Samaritan came along, and when he saw the man, he felt compassion for him, very much like the competitor in the other car that was trying to win the race that decided, rather than win, he would stop and try to help. Going over to him, the Samaritan soothed his wounds with olive oil and wine and bandaged them, and then he put the man on his own donkey and took him to an inn where he took care of him. See, compassion is stopping to do what you can do. See, the fire marshals had fire extinguishers, and they could have done what they were trained to do, and that's extinguish the fire, but they didn't stop and do what they could do. I mean, the police were there to help protect that driver, and they could have went and helped that race car driver turn that car over, but they didn't stop to do what they could do. Yet this one man, he got out of his car and did everything he could do. He ran and got in a fire extinguisher. He tried to get the car over, and he cared for one of his fellow competitors that was trying to beat him in a race. But compassion isn't always this dramatic scene. It's not always the car's on fire or there's a man half dead on the street. It's sometimes someone that's grieving and they need someone to talk to. Sometimes it's someone is diagnosed with cancer and they need a phone call, a word of encouragement. And sometimes it's someone on the side of the road that has a flat tire and they simply need a helping hand. I mean, sometimes it's the mother. She's pulling her hair out because she's raising three kids and she doesn't know what she's going to do next and she just needs a babysitter. Sometimes it's someone that's trying to operate a copier machine, like this morning. Did you know copying machines are demon-possessed? They're of the devil. Copy machines are. I heard wails and cries in the copying room this morning. This thing, it's broke, it won't work. And I was walking down the hallway coming in here to do what I needed to do. And I heard these calls and I thought about the message I was preaching today. And I took two steps and then planted and went back and helped the person fix the copy machine because I know how to unjam a copy machine. I'm an expert in casting those demons out. Because we can't make the lame to walk again. We can't cast out a disease like leprosy. We can't feed 5,000 people like Jesus did with a few fish and some loaves of bread. But we can see a need and stop and do what we can do. So be different and be compassionate. It's okay to get angry. It's okay to get disappointed. It's okay to feel the feelings of betrayal. But it's not okay to stay there and use those as excuses to no longer be compassionate to people who we could help, right? Jesus didn't stay angry. Jesus didn't stay disappointed. Jesus didn't stay, oh my, I've been betrayed. And you know, no. What did Jesus do? He went and taught in that temple. He went and died on a cross for our sins. He continued to heal people and teach his disciples even though they were lacking faith, right? So that's what we need to do. See, 2 Corinthians 1:4 says this, he comforts us in all of our troubles. And some of you are wondering, why am I going through this trouble? Well, this is why. God comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort others. We can be compassionate. We can be moved. When they are troubled, we will be able to give them the same comfort God has given us, right? The trial you're going through is qualifying you right now to show compassion and be a comfort to someone down the road. And so we got kids going back to school. Can you believe it? You know, kids are going back to school soon. And we do have families that needs some help with some school supplies. I think we've done this for 26 years now, but our annual school supply drive out in the foyer, this is one way to be compassionate, to be different. You can grab a box, go buy the school supplies, bring it back, and we work with Canton City school officials to make sure the kids get the boxes and the families get the boxes who need to get the boxes. That's one way that you can be compassionate and help out as a response to this message. But as we close today, I'm so excited because we had a team that decided to stop everything that they were doing. All young people, young adults, decided to go to Costa Rica, make a difference down there. They put their lives on hold, their lives on pause for about 10 days, 2 weeks, and traveled to Costa Rica to be compassionate, to do what they could do. And so we're gonna play a short video here that highlights some of what happened, and you'll hear some of their voices in this video. And as the video is playing, we have four young adults that are going to come out here and just share briefly what God taught them and exposed them to as they made a decision to be different and be compassionate.
A trip like this can mean a lot of things. For me, it was about relationships.
Joy. servanthood.
Pura Vida. Focus on the simple things in life and appreciate the beauty around us. Teamwork.
Community.
Connections. Connections are made every time you engage with someone.
Bigger picture. Relationships.
Surrender.
Infinite, didactic,
inspired.
This is Faith and Josh and Lane and Tori, and these were four of the young adults that went down on this missions trip. And so we're going to ask each one a question. Now, Faith, this was your very first missions trip, correct? And so a lot of times there's some unexpected things that happen and unexpected lessons from God. So could you share one of those with us this morning?
Yeah. So for me, what was unexpected was the community aspect of everything. I was expecting to go and work, like get what we needed to get done and kind of leave. But there was a lot of community that I wasn't expecting. They said that like our family was their family, their church is our church, their house is our house, things like that. And there was a lot less of a workplace environment as I was expecting, and more of a like a lot very welcoming.
So yeah, it's just when you went and helped, you made a whole new family, it sounds like then.
Yeah.
Cool. Josh, he is our local ninja warrior. He has his own Instagram page, so if you Google Josh Larson, ninja warrior on Instagram, however you do it, I don't know. This guy can do some crazy stuff. You should check him out. But what did you learn, you know, lesson learned from going down on this missions trip?
Yeah, so I learned that it is very important to step out of your comfort zone, because I know a lot of us were really nervous about going down there, especially since most of us don't speak much Spanish at all. And when we were down there, I started to realize that it didn't really matter as much as I thought it would that we didn't speak Spanish, because joy is a universal language.
Amen.
And you don't need to speak Spanish to smile and play with the kids and work and worship. I learned stepping out of your comfort zone can change lives.
Right, amen. And Lane, now you didn't grow up in a church at all, right? This is your first church family.
Sure.
So praise God for that. And it's an awesome church family. You picked a good one. But, you know, life is full of adversity, and even when you try to be compassionate, things don't always go well, so there's adversity. So I know you faced some adversity on the trip. So what adversity did you face, and how did God work through that adversity?
I'd say one of the biggest challenges was definitely the language barrier, like Josh said. When they were trying to communicate with you and you couldn't communicate with them how you wanted to, it was kind of tough. But another thing is I was in the hospital 2 days in for a bacterial infection, so I couldn't really help as much as I wanted to. And do the work. And then one day we had a tourism day, and I wasn't feeling well, and I planned on not going. And Josh, Sean, and Luke came in and prayed over me, and I felt the Holy Spirit just come in the room. And less than 6 hours later, I was feeling great, and like nothing happened. And I was able to go enjoy their time and finish off working and helping the way I wanted to.
Amen, amen, amen. So this guy goes on a missions trip, ends up in the ER, in the hospital for 2 days. But God, wow, showed himself faithful and rewarded you for your obedience. Praise the Lord. Tori, now there are, you know, lessons that we learn from certain experiences that just we take for life, right? They're just not just in the moment, but for a lifetime. So I know you learned one of those lessons that you're going to carry on for the rest of your life. So could you just share that with the group?
Okay, so I had to learn to push myself both physically and mentally, because not only did the hot days drain our energy and the rain shortened our days, which was a disappointment to the majority of the team, but I also went into the trip not really getting along with all of the team members, and some of the actions taken by them had me frustrated the majority of the days on the trip. So I had to keep telling myself to change my attitude, because the trip wasn't about myself. It was about God. And so the lesson I learned was to have more perseverance and self-control for God's glory and mission.
So about 2 years ago, Ron Gay in a leadership team meeting said, I just have a passion that our young people would get involved in missions because I'm getting old. I don't know how longer I can do this. And so honestly, this is a miracle. This is an answer to prayer, because we had a whole team of young people get involved in world missions. And I believe God did some amazing things in their hearts and lives. And here we sit today, 2 years later, living proof that God answers prayer, and God has a bigger vision for our lives than just to get caught up in ourselves. We need to be outside of ourselves, be different, and be compassionate, okay? So I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet. We're going to pray. We're going to sing one more song. Jesus, we love you. We thank you that you didn't stay angry. We thank you that you didn't stay disappointed. We thank you that you didn't quit because you were betrayed. Oh, but Jesus, you went to that cross. You died on that cross for our sins. You were in the grave. You rose from the dead on the third day. And now we are your hands and feet. The church is the body of Christ. And we can be different. We can be compassionate. We can change the world. We can do what you are calling us to do. We can get outside our comfort zone. We can take risks and chances, all for the glory of God. Amen, church? Amen. And so, God, as we sing to you this powerful song, speak to us, inspire us, encourage us. If any of us have lost the compassion, give us a fresh filling this morning, God. In Jesus' precious name.
Thanks for watching. If this message helped you, share it with someone you know. And don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. If you live in the area, we invite you to join us for one of our worship experiences. Go to CantonNazarene.com for times and more information. Hey, thanks for being a part of our virtual community.